So Ryan, we have a pickle to deal with today.
Great.
Someone's business problem, for those of you that don't know what a pickle is. And it's an interesting one, actually, because I think a number of people tend to get this wrong. But this is from Catherine, and she asks, how can I establish a reputation for low prices without seeming to be cheap and low quality?
Yeah.
It's a bit of an issue, isn't it?
It is. It's really hard. In fact, in talking with marketers over the years, this might be like the fundamental problem for a lot of businesses. You want to have that reputation for low prices. You want to have a reputation for high quality. The fundamental problem is that these two ideas are in conflict in the minds of most customers. Like, we know how markets work. We all kind of believe there's no free lunch out there. And so if you try to communicate low price, you are kind of hand in hand communicating low quality. And if you want to communicate high quality, you were kind of hand in hand communicating high price. And so creating a break between those two ideas so that somebody can hold these conflicting ideas simultaneously, that's really hard. That's really difficult. I will preface this. We are not going to resolve this. Like I said, this is kind of fundamental. I will give the best advice that I can. This is actually an area of research for me. My dissertation was on kind of reputation for prices. So I'll tell you what the research shows, but I don't want to fool anybody into thinking like, oh, these irreconcilable differences, we can just smash them together. We'll do the best we can. And it'll point you in the right direction. But this is hard. This is a really hard problem to solve.
So maybe we should start off by giving people some examples that they would would know about. Because one of them, as you were just even talking there, that came to my mind was Amazon. Mm-hmm. I mean, I wouldn't consider Amazon to be low quality.
Yeah.
In fact, thinking about it, they've been driving the market in many innovations, including low price. That's one. The other one that I would give you as a suggestion is there's a store that in my local town in where I live in Dunstable in England called Dunstable Discount, and that has a reputation for being low price, but also low quality. it's the classic, I wouldn't really go there unless I really want something incredibly cheap. Yeah. I guess as I was thinking about that, it's just even goes down to the look of the place, doesn't it? So are there any examples that you would give?
Excellent. Yeah. I'll fold in some specific examples as we get to some of the specific advice.
Okay.
But you illustrate kind of the one end of the extreme here, and then also a place showing that it is possible, right? So if you call your store a discount store, that comes with this whole raft of associations with it. Among them, it's going to be low quality, right? Like that's kind of baked into that association. Amazon is one of these unique cases where I do think that they developed a reputation for high quality, especially if within quality, we include things like service quality, like speed of delivery, that still has a low price reputation. Interestingly, over time, I think when Amazon started, back when it was Amazon.com and they only shipped books, I think they had a really low price image. Like that was they had very low. And over time, I think it's crept up. I think it's not as low as it used to be. It's still low, right? I think it's still not seen as like a high-priced seller. But I think part of that is exactly this trade-off. Like as they've improved service, as they've become more convenient, as they've done all these things to improve kind of the quality of the offering, reputation for prices has crept up a little bit as well. Showing the difficulty of these things are linked.
Sure.
All right. Let me give you some broad advice here. There's kind of two categories. We'll call it three categories of advice that I'll give on this.
Right.
Let's start with the one that you were hinting at before, which is not what I'm going to call non-price factors that drive your reputation for pricing. You mentioned decor. There's a lot of research on price image. I've done some of it. And a lot of it focuses on what we can do with the prices to communicate a reputation for pricing one way or the other. And I find that very interesting. And we'll go over some of it. I'm of the personal belief, but that's like kind of the academic side. Like we're very interested in prices. It's very fun to play around with numbers and see how people do with numbers. I'm convinced if I was running a store and I wanted to communicate a price image, I'm convinced that these non-price factors are more important.
Right.
There's a lot of research on it, but I think that it's more important in communicating things. So let's talk about some of them. Decor is one. So there, I'm sure that all of our listeners have been in an experience where they've gone into a store and drawn a conclusion about how expensive the store is before they see the first price tag.
Sure.
So if you go in and the decor is very high end, the displays are very beautiful, there's lots of service personnel waiting to, you know, answer your questions and guide you through this. All of that sends a signal that the prices are high without us actually messing with the prices. Which is very interesting for this price quality link. The reverse can also be true. There's this anecdote where Walmart decided several years ago that they wanted to kind of clean up their stores. They had a reputation for having kind of dingy, cluttered stores. So they didn't drop pallets of goods in the middle of the aisles anymore. Yeah. And they had, the lighting was brighter, and they made sure that to sweep the floors more often. People started complaining about the higher prices.
Wow.
They did that.
Wow. Just because of that. Yeah.
So if you want a reputation for low prices, and you don't want to necessarily sacrifice your reputation for quality, one thing that you can do is use these indirect signals of low prices. There's another story that the first Home Depot that was opened as a DIY shop in the US, the very first one that opened, the morning or the night before it opened, some employee went through and shined all the floors. The concrete floors, so that it'd be nice and ready for a grand opening. And the founder was furious, and he told them to get out their skid steers and scuff up all the floors. He didn't want to send the signal that this is like a high priced store. He wanted this to look like a lived in store, someplace that construction workers would go, a warehouse. And so he was sending these signals that no, this is a low priced store. And those signals, the connection between those signals and quality is weaker, right? So when you go into a Costco or a Sam's Club, you've got concrete floors and warehouse shelving and industrial lighting. And all of these things send a low price signal without necessarily sending as strong a signal that it's low quality.
And I presume you can't quantify that. You can't turn around and say that's worth 10% of revenue, or
you could
a reduction be very, of 10% of the price,
I mean, if you're good at survey taking and you can kind of measure how these things change out, I could do it in a hypothetical scenario. Show people pictures of different stores where I scuff up the floors and Photoshop in one versus another, and then I could measure their anticipated willingness to pay, all that kind of stuff. These are, when I talk about price image or reputation for pricing, I describe it as the intersection between pricing and branding. And so just like a lot of times your brand is difficult to quantify, if Coca-Cola puts out some ads talking about how Coke makes you happy, it's going to be really hard to tie that back to revenue. But we have this kind of belief that it matters, right? I think that the price image is in that same kind of, so it is quantifiable to an extent, but not as much. Service is another one. So if you want to create a great customer experience and high level service, the risk there, the potential downside is people could start to assume your prices are higher, right? as we're balancing this price quality trade-off thing, if we use these indirect signals, a lot of times that'll have more of an effect on our price image than our quality image.
Yeah, so it's making me think that clearly, you know, the whole of the environment matters. And again, I guess the whole of the issue is of segmentation. So, you know, what are you used to? What, you know, somebody that normally shops in a high-end shop could think that the prices are going to be lower, et cetera, et cetera. But it was also making me think about in the B2B environment. And I wondered how this sort of, you could make this play out in that B2B environment. So just follow me through for a moment. You know, if you get a team of five people all come dressed in their designer shirts and all turn up in Porsche cars,
yep,
and you know, all those things, and of all, I'm exaggerating now to make a point, all got a personal assistant with them.
Yep.
You know, that would be a different image to, I don't know if you've ever seen that TV series on Netflix, Better Call Saul.
Yep.
You know, where you've got the person. So it's like, well, what are you dressed as? But I suppose that would apply just as much in a store or in a B2C as it does in a B2B.
I think that's an excellent parallel there, right? And so this isn't B2B, but like I had a similar experience to the one you're describing. My garage would leak when it rained. So there'd be a little bit of flooding that would come in. And so we wanted to get some people out to kind of quote solutions for that. And I had somebody pull up to for digging out a drain, which is not a glamorous solution, right?
Sure. They're
gonna jackhammer concrete and put a drain in. This guy pulled up in the nicest Mercedes I have ever seen, the salesperson, to quote me. And I didn't even need to hear him. He had a tailored button-down shirt with the logo of the drain system solution on there.
Yes.
He had a laptop where he could provide the cuz. I didn't need to hear the bid. I knew this was not going to be something I could afford. But it's exactly that. Yeah, so these signals do not need to happen inside a store. Your salespeople are sending signals.
Yes.
And so, you know, there's kind of this, for a lot of industries, you want the salespeople to look nice and they want to have nice cars, and salespeople tend to make a lot within the organization. And, but all those things send signals. And they can.
Funny enough.
Go ahead.
Sorry. I was thinking, funny enough, the other day, as I was following a van and all of the sign writing for the van was peeling off.
Yeah.
And I was thinking to myself as I was following, I was thinking to myself, you know, that impacts on the image of the company that you can't even be bothered to get, you know, to have the sign writing or the stickers or whatever else that, you know, that fit on properly. So if you turned up to my house and said you were going to do this, I would start looking at those subconscious signs to go, actually, is the quality of the work the type of work that I want to get, basically.
So this is great, right? So this is, let's remember the question. The question was, how can I send a high price signal without signaling low quality?
Which is the conflicting
part, obviously. Think about these signals, though, that we've been talking about.
Sure.
You want to look for opportunities where the signal is going to send a stronger low price signal than it will a low quality signal. I think that what you identified, you know, if somebody's got the van is falling apart as they pull in, that to me would probably send a stronger low quality signal than it would a low price signal. So that's the opposite of what you want.
Sure.
Think instead of a van that pulls up that's not like super glitzy, but it's well maintained. And instead of like a salesperson who's wearing very nice loafers steps out of the van, instead it looks like somebody, like an engineer, right? It looks like somebody who's done the work and they're dressed in kind of a non-fussy way.
Yeah.
That might send a high quality signal without sending as strong of a high price signal.
Yeah.
So that would be what you want.
But it's a balance, isn't it? Because yes. to your yeah, point about exactly the guy right. that turned up at your place, you know, it is you don't want to go over the top, do you?
Yeah. I mean, he was sending a high quality signal too. Like I believed this was probably the best solution in the business. And if it wasn't my garage that was leaking, if instead it was my finished basement,
sure.
then I might have been more open to the idea of like, oh, well, I want something that I can trust. And so this yes. might have worked great there.
Yes.
Yeah. You're always going to be sending a signal from which people can draw both price and quality inferences. What you yeah. want to look for is those cases where they're imbalanced, where you're sending a stronger low price than low quality, or vice versa.
So I can think of lots of quality examples. What's a price example?
Like I said, they're linked, right? So if you walk into, I mean, one example I've used before is legal services. So there's lots of legal services that you have to buy that most people don't have any idea how much they should cost. So if you walk into a law office right. and say, I want to get a will and trust yes. set up, you know, if they offered to charge you $2,000 for that, like, is that a good price for that? I have no idea.
Right.
If I walk in though, and it's like the office is in a high rise and it's all glass walls and doors everywhere.
Yeah.
I'm going to assume that $2,000 is a high price for that legal right. service, as opposed right. to if I walk into a law office that's like a converted house.
So how does that tie in with reference points then? Because, so are you using your reference points as the facilities that are around you or the other things that are around right. you?
Think of these as two or three different ways of evaluating prices, right? So right. you can have reference prices that are based on your experience. So internal reference prices, yeah. you can external. So these are reference prices based on the environment, the other things you see on the store yeah. shelf, or based on the reputation of the firm. So all of right. these things are still at play. When we're dealing with the reputation of the firm as a whole, we need to kind of scale up from any individual price to the brand.
Sure. Okay.
All right. So that's one set of advice. And I think that's a very powerful way of communicating. Think yeah. about the signals that you're sending and look for those asymmetric signals, the signals that will send a stronger low price signal than they will a low quality signal.
Sure.
So that's one. You can mess with the pricing itself. So I like I said, there's a big body of research on this. I won't bore everybody by digging into the details. I'll point out one. So there's kind of two broad pricing strategies that firms engage in. One is EDLP, or everyday low pricing, and the other is high-low pricing. And the basic idea is, you know, there are grocery stores and furniture stores where we're going to give you the lowest price across the board and everything we can. There are other sure. stores where it's like, well, our everyday prices might be a little bit higher, but every once in a while, we're going to offer really deep discounts and you'll get the best price on the stuff right. that's discounted. The way people infer a reputation from those two strategies depends on whether they are looking at it from the outside, kind of before they go in, or whether they're evaluating the prices once they're in the store. From the outside, before you go in, an everyday low pricing strategy communicates low prices better, right? So if a store said, like your discount, what was it? Dunshire discount or?
Dunstable discount.
Mine is better. Dunshire sounds better than Dunstable. That's some better mistake.
I'll have to go and live there then.
Yeah, it's a class here. Fake.
I didn't realize I'd come out of this podcast having to move.
But that's, you know, if it's got the word discount on it, like that's a very clear yeah. low price signal and therefore yeah. also probably low quality.
Sure.
But once you're inside the store, and this is some research that I just published last year, once you're inside the store, that flips. Because when you're looking at all of the offerings in front of you, the fact that some of them are very deeply discounted, that sends a strong low price signal. And I would argue the higher prices in there also sends a higher quality signal. So if you're trying to lure people into the store in the first place and you're trying to communicate low prices, everyday low pricing probably works better. But once people are inside the store, I think a high-low pricing strategy where you discount deeply some of the stuff that you're offering, I think that sends a lower quality and a lower price and a higher quality signal. Does that make sense?
It does, yeah. I was just thinking that whenever I've been into a store like that, a discount store like that, that it's strange that even some of the branded goods feel not as good.
Yeah.
Because I don't know why I was thinking about it, but I was thinking of ketchup, you know, and getting Heinz ketchup. Whereas when you buy it at a discount store, my immediate reaction thinking about it is, my immediate reaction would be to check the date actually to make sure that, you know, it all wasn't going to go out of date next week or whatever. But it doesn't feel as, even with those high-end branded good, not the Heinz ketchup's particularly high-end all, but you get the idea.
I'm a ketchup snob. I care very much about the brand of my ketchup.
But it feels like that's not as good a quality. And yep. That clearly is not the case, is it?
Well, maybe. There's some research looking at price placebo effects.
Right.
And they did find that somewhere deep inside of us, we tend to kind of assume that it doesn't work as well if it's bought on discount or if it's in kind of this low price.
Yeah, market. No, that's so true.
So yeah, there may be something to that, even if it is a national brand. So the power of these halo effects can be very strong.
Sure.
They can influence them all.
Sure.
All right, so look for these imbalanced non-price signals. Look for these asymmetric price signals as well. Right? Sure. My advice would be high-low pricing will tend to communicate that better in most situations. And then the last one, and I think maybe the most important one, we've talked over and over again about how these ideas are in conflict. It's very difficult for people to reconcile the fact that a brand or a store might be both low price and high quality. So my advice is you need to provide your customers with a story to reconcile this conflicting information. So
right.
Come up with a plausible explanation for why you violate the market norm, why it is possible that you have both right. lower prices and high quality, and right. make that compelling and make that a part of your pitch. So I think right. IKEA does this well. IKEA doesn't have a reputation for having super high quality sure. furniture, but if we include like design, aesthetics within kind of sure. quality, IKEA makes good stuff. It's stuff that people sure. tend to like. Sure. And they've got a very clear story for how they can offer low prices and reasonable quality stuff.
Sure. Right? They
save money because they flat pack everything. They make you assemble it. They make you, muscle it out of the aisle.
They don't allow you to go on any shortcuts when you're walking through the store. You have to go That's through true. The whole yes. bloody store.
They make you walk the entire maze in order to find your way out again, if you can. but they've got a story. They explain why it's possible to have the quality that they do at the low price that they do.
Sure.
Anytime a store talks about cutting out the middleman, right? That's
yeah.
that's an explanation, right? We have to offer the same yeah. quality at a lower price. Why? Because there are fewer links in the chain that need to extract profit.
Yeah.
And that more efficient system yeah. allows us to have quality at low price.
It's interesting you say that because I can think of two examples of that. One is actually Amazon, as we've yep. talked about.
Yeah. I think going back to your initial example, I think that Amazon has a compelling story. They'll yeah. tell you why they're able to do this.
Yeah,
and we all kind of believe them, and so that
and I think it's a historical thing with them, wasn't it? Which is because we are now online, and therefore it's going to be cheaper, and therefore yeah. Blah 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 blah, and that sort of just carried on. Basically, I think it's actually interesting with them that they seem to be heading into some problems recently on things like the Prime membership and stuff. I don't know if you've seen that latest stuff around that. But not allowing customers to easily stop Prime membership and stuff like that.
No, I haven't heard, maybe that's a subject of a separate podcast.
But I don't know if you've ever tried to stop Amazon's Prime membership. It's difficult because I've tried. Whereas if I compared it against something like Netflix, it's very simple to stop Netflix. So anyway, one issue. The second one, the second story that that came to my mind was Costco. And yeah, again, I'm not sure how true this is, but the story I've heard is that they only take a 15% profit margin on everything.
I've heard it's even lower than that. I've heard that they make almost all of their profit off of the membership fee, and they sell almost
everything. Yeah, no, I've heard that as well.
I also do not have confirmation on that. But I've heard that from either way, they make low profit. I think we can feel confident in saying off of each sale.
Because that's interesting in itself, isn't it? Which is, so we've got two stories there.
Yeah.
But we've just, you know, both heard rumors around these things. I can't turn around and say, look at that report or look at that study that tells you this.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting when your business model becomes part of the marketing pitch. I think Walmart, especially in the early days of Walmart, part of their story was they have this super efficient distribution network. So they would move into a place by first establishing a distribution point and then building stores out around it so that they could be efficient, so that they could have low prices. There's really no reason customers should care, right? There's no reason that you need to tell me about your distribution. Sure. Like, I don't, but it was a story that allowed people to understand why Walmart could offer national brands at such a low price.
But it's an explanation, isn't it? Because if I go back to my ketchup example of earlier, if they had told me why the Heinz ketchup in this discount store was particularly low, then I may not have questioned the viability of buying that, whatever.
That's exactly what we need. Yeah. Yeah. So if I can say like, oh, we only buy overstock from other places, or we only buy whatever, we cut out the middleman. Now we're reconciling these conflicting bits of information.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's a good one, actually. I like that. And the more I think about that, the more I'm thinking of even home improvement companies with, you know, double glazing and stuff like that. There's manufacturers in Florida that they produce it at their own factory, and therefore it's going to be cheaper and blah, 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 you know. So I can see the adverts now. So good.
So that's it. Those are my three bits of information. You want to look for asymmetric communications, things that will send a stronger low price signal than a low quality signal. Those can be non-price signals, like decor, things like that. They can be pricing, the way that you construct your pricing strategy. And then the most important advice that I have is you need an explanation. You need a story that you can tell customers that will help them understand how it's possible that these two things that should not coexist do for you.
Sure. Makes a great deal of sense, mate. That's really good. And Catherine, I hope that's been of use to you. If anybody else has got a pickle they want to send in, then all you have to do is to go to beyondphilosophy.com/pickle. That's beyondphilosophy.com/pickle. You can even record your pickle there, and we'll put it on the show and hopefully give you some explanation of what's happening and some advice of what to do. Hope that's been of use to you this week, and we look forward to talking to you next week. Cheers. Thanks so much for watching. And if you enjoyed this video, please make sure you subscribe so you don't miss an episode.